नमस्कार, नियमित प्रस्तुति कार्यक्रम छ प्रश्नमा यहाँहरूलाई स्वागत छ। म रचना पौडेल। दर्शकवृन्द, पत्रकारिता क्षेत्र निकै संवेदनशील क्षेत्र मानिन्छ र विश्वभरमा नै धेरै पत्रकारहरू पनि छन्। तर देश भूगोल अनुसार पत्रकारहरूको पनि भूमिका आफ्नो ठाउँमा हुन्छ नै, फरक फरक भूमिका हुन्छ र विश्वका कति विकसितदेखि लिएर अल्प विकसित देशमा विभिन्न धारका पत्रकारहरूले देशको समग्र परिस्थितिलाई सञ्चार माध्यमबाट जानकारी दिइरहेका हुन्छन्, चाहे त्यो सकारात्मक होस् या नकारात्मक। यसबीचमा पत्रकारले खेल्न सक्ने भूमिका एउटा ठाउँको लागि, एउटा गाउँको लागि र देशका लागि, सम्पूर्ण देशभरिका व्यक्तिहरूका लागि, विश्वका लागि कति महत्त्वपूर्ण हुन्छ। विगत लामो समयदेखि अति विकसित राष्ट्र अमेरिकामा बसेर पत्रकारिता गर्नुभएका एकजना महिला पत्रकारको अनुभव आज समग्र रूपमा हामी खोतल्ने प्रयास गर्नेछौँ। र आज हामीसँग हुनुहुन्छ अमेरिकी पत्रकार डेबोरा पोर्टर। वेलकम टु द शो।
थ्याङ्क यू भेरी मच, प्लीज टु बी हियर।
डु यु एक्चुअली रिलेट विथ ह्यारी पोर्टर?
Yes, he's my nephew. Just kidding.
Wow. That's an interesting part. Jokes apart.
Tell you, people can spell my name now. Before they could not, now I just say, just so like
is
Harry.
Is it Deborah?
Yes,
Deborah. Okay. Yeah. So, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
It's really good talking with you now. You've spent a short, a long decade in journalism. Can you share your experience with us?
What is it to be a journalist? That's a whole book.
Personally, I'm very keen. I'm very interested because I'm also a journalist.
Right. I think journalists need to be and are very curious people. They always ask why. They want to know why things happen, what happened exactly, but also what does it mean? Mm-hmm. And so journalists are very curious. Journalists also love to tell stories. Mm-hmm. So they are very good, typically, at taking a lot of information and making meaning out of that. A real news story is not a list of facts, right, in a row, mm-hmm. But rather it has a beginning, a middle, an end. It has strong characters. It has plot. It has a scene. It's really a whole story. And I think people who are good at journalism love to tell stories.
Okay. So as being a part, you have worked in a very profound, topmost organization, news organization like CNN, CBS. Mm. What is it to be a part of a CNN, the renowned organization, news broadcasting channel? What is it to be like? And what do you find? How have you observed and encountered the differentiation between different states, like Western journalism, Eastern journalism, Southern journalism? What it is to be a part of those journalists?
I think there are some universals that apply to journalism around the world. There are international principles and standards that we all uphold. We may have different resources. We may have more people, fewer people. We may have more space, less space. But I think all of us try to do really good, solid journalism based on fact, based on careful reporting, based on verification. All of those things are universal. The advantage that some of the really big news organizations have is they have more people, more layers, so that a reporter is not working all alone. Mm-hmm. And yet, it's very typical now at everywhere but those really big news organizations for reporters to work by themselves, shoot their video, edit their video. That's not something you only see in Nepal. You
exactly.
See it everywhere.
Okay. So you've worked like 6 and more years in a journalism sector. And before that, you were also a news anchor in a news radio. So what was your experience like to be a woman journalist at that point of time, at that time period? There was not any familiarity in a journalism, especially for a woman. So how challenging it was, what were the drawbacks, what were the obstacles that you faced as being a women journalist, and what is the level of women journalists now and then?
So I think it's changed a lot. There were certainly trailblazers who went before me. We have had women journalists who covered the Vietnam War, for example. We had women journalists back in the very early days covering the White House. So we've always had a few. When I started, it was the beginning of the explosion of women in journalism. Mm-hmm. So I was really at the very beginning of a trend. Mm-hmm. And I often say that I had the great good fortune of coming into my profession, as many other women did at that same mm-hmm. time, when the government was looking at various news organizations, but also businesses, and saying, you cannot discriminate when you hire people. You cannot say, we need a man for this position. You have to talk to women, at least. And it helped, I think, for me, and it helped a lot of women get started at that time. Nevertheless, there were very few of us. Mm-hmm. And so we, I think, supported each other and moved forward together. Mm-hmm. And even despite the lack of support from some of our male colleagues, we stuck to it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's it takes a certain amount of passion for the job to put up with some of the negatives that also go along with being a woman in a profession that is dominated by men.
Exactly.
We're not at equal pay yet around the country. Women, to some degree, are still paid somewhat less than men. But in journalism, it's much more even than it used to be. And we certainly aren't 50% female in the newsroom, but we're a lot closer than we used to be. And what's really changed is that many of the news managers are now women. And that makes a huge difference.
That's a good thing we can know. As we are also women journalists, so what do you see? What are the future of journalism? Especially, you're here in Nepal. What is the purpose of being in Nepal? Is it your first time, or you have already visited many more times before?
So I've not been to Nepal before. It's my first visit to Nepal. I was invited here to meet with journalists, to meet with people using social media, and to talk about...
What did you absorb? What did you encounter? What was your supervision in a journalism sector in Nepal, a country like... It's a least developed country. So what do you find? What do you see the future of Nepali journalism?
So I think it's, you know, the sky's the limit. I think that what you see a lot in developing countries is that they have leapfrogged. They have jumped over some of the barriers that the developed countries had to resist or break through because they didn't have the old way, right? You didn't have to change from the old way to the new way. You just start doing the new way. And I think that's a real advantage. So you can be very nimble. You know, you're not, people don't stop you and say, oh, we don't do it that way. We've never done that before, which is a big barrier sometimes in well-established newsrooms, right? They have, they have the old way. And I think it's really great to be in a country where things are all new. You know, things work well, right? They're using all kinds of different media to communicate. They're at that forward position without ever having to break through all the old stuff to get there.
So as being a professional and a very experienced journalist, what do you think, what are the criterias and what are the circumstances to be fulfilled for the proper journalist? What are the roles and responsibility that have to be fulfilled?
Well, as I said, I think there are international standards that we all have to, that most journalists would say they support. And I tend to put them in four categories. The first category is to tell the truth, to seek the truth, and to report what you find. We're not historians, so we can't wait till we have the whole truth about something, but I think we seek it, and as we go, we make sure that it is accurate. So accuracy really matters, and we are devoted to the truth. It's the number one thing that we are devoted to. Secondly, I think most journalists I talk to want to be independent. Now, that doesn't mean they don't want to be paid. They would like to be paid, so they may work for a news organization, but that news organization, however it makes its money, advertising, you know, they get support from their listeners and viewers, whatever, that does not influence the journalism, right? The journalists are independent. They work independently of their advertisers, independently of their sources. They really attempt to be representatives of the public and not of any special interest. The third thing is that they seek to minimize the harm that their work is going to do. Minimize. We're not doctors, so we don't take the Hippocratic oath and we promise we will do no harm. But we seek to minimize it, which means we try to treat people humanely. We try to be understanding of the situations that people are in. We don't go racing after victims with microphones and cameras saying, how do you feel, right? We try not to. Sometimes I see that in my own country. I think it's bad journalism. And the final point is that we want to be accountable for what we do. That means we're accountable to ourselves, to our own standards, to our colleagues in our newsroom, to other journalists, and to the public. So when we make a mistake, we say so. We correct it. We try very hard not to make mistakes. And we're also attempting to be more transparent about what we do. We explain how we got a story. We identify where the story came from as much as we possibly can. So people say transparency is the new objectivity. I often hear that. I think objectivity is an unreachable goal, really. What we don't want to be is biased, right? But we do obviously bring our own background, our own culture, everything to our reporting. We just need to be aware of that, put it over here when we're doing our reporting and not let it influence us too much.
Okay, so let's come to the fact that you are also correspondents for Religious and Ethnic News Weekly. So you've been working in this field. Let's be concerned on religious and ethnic. So what do you think, what are the happening issues you can like analyze and observe now in the world?
so I was
unrelated to religion.
I understand what you're saying. I was a contributing correspondent to a public television program that was on the air for 20 years. So it's a long time for a public TV show to run. It went off the air this year, so I'm no longer reporting for them because they no longer exist.
Okay.
The focus of that program was religion and ethics, Newsweekly. So we looked at ethical behavior. So for instance, lots of things in the medical field, right? What is ethical? Are we going to have robots that can act as humans? Are they going to be thinking robots? And what does that mean for the world? You know, how will the world change? So those kinds of futuristic issues we looked at. We also looked at issues of religion. And not only sort of what people of faith, deep faith, and how they what they believe and how they act their lives, but also the conflicts between them, which is clearly an issue, a story that's as old as time, and it's still with us today.
So what do you have to say about the you know, hot and happening issue on religion and ethic-based news, like Rohingya Muslims, Rohingya refugees, one of the most happening news and dealt by United Nations. What do you have to say about this most devastating and concerned issue? How do you analyze as a journalist?
I haven't been covering that story, but obviously I've been reading about it and watching stories about it, and it's very, very difficult. It's, I think, perplexing to a lot of people because, particularly in the West, where there is this sort of assumption that Hindu people behave a certain way, right? They are peaceful and they are peace-loving, and then something like this happens, and it's shocking, I think, to a lot of people. So it's been puzzling, and it's been a very big topic of discussion as well.
Don't you think it's a kind of a scary job, journalism? You're working in a religious and ethical issue, and it's a very, very much happening issue, and a very dangerous, important as well. But in some and the other way, journalists are not secure. So what do you have to say about this, safety and security?
It's a major issue, and I think that it's not just if you're covering a war zone or a zone in which there's military activity that's obviously dangerous, but it's also dangerous just being in the street, right? Being out in the street where people can see you doing your work. Some people don't like journalists, and they say bad things, they yell nasty things at you when you're trying to be live on television. That's a problem. But we even had, within the last couple of years, journalists shot to death while doing their jobs, while being out on television, because there's so much hatred going around. So yes, it's a very, very dangerous job. I think journalists need support. They need to be trained how to stay safe. So they need actual training support, but also, their managers need to be aware of the lack of safety, of the danger, and not send people by themselves into dangerous situations, right? Or recognize that if a reporter calls back from the field and says, I don't feel safe here, I'm uncomfortable, this is not going well, that they shouldn't say, well, you just stay there, it's your job, but rather to say, you're right, no story is worth anyone's life.
Okay, so there might be other issues, there are religious and ethnical issues that we might not get aware of. So what do you have to say? Is there other issues that we are not aware of and the world is facing and you are working on it, focusing on the religious and ethnical based news?
So, I mean, I think there are just multiple stories everywhere. Everywhere you turn, there are stories. And faith, people's faith, it's a very personal thing, but it helps to make them who they are. So I think there's almost always a component of that in stories. It may not be on the surface. It may be hard to get to. You have to ask questions carefully, right? But I think it's often there. And it's a dimension of stories that makes stories more universal, more appealing. Because if you talk about your faith, right, in connection, not you personally, but in connection with the story, then I can relate to that. I can understand that. Even though I may be of a completely different faith, I can understand how that plays a role. And I personally would like to see that kind of coverage not segregated in a program about that, but rather more widely distributed, because it's fascinating.
Yeah, lately religion has, ethnical issues has led up to the conflictual incidents, moments lately. Religion has been the happening issue. So what do you have to say about this? Why is it happening as a journalist? How have you analyzed and covered the issues? And had we able to cover the, more of a issues?
So I think that it's not a new thing. You know, yes, it seems to be very prominent today, the conflict between people who come from different religious backgrounds. But if you look at history, it goes back into prehistory, right? There has always been this kind of conflict. Why? Because it's so personal. Because it's part of who we are. It's not like, oh, I disagree with you because I don't like the color green. Mm-hmm. That's not really part of who I am. Mm-hmm. But my faith, my background, my family, all of that is very personal. And so it becomes a really significant piece of, you know, who we are, and both individually and sort of culturally, so differences between cultures. So I would sort of disagree that it's a new thing. I think it's always been there. It bubbles up, it backs down, it bubbles up. So for journalists, it's complicated, right? It's not an easy topic to cover. Mm-hmm. And it pays to be prepared when you go into a story like that, to know something. It is not productive to send in a reporter who has no idea about the differences between two belief systems,
exactly.
And just comes in and you know skips over the surface of a story. It requires some hard work. Now, I use the term training. You can train yourself as well. You don't need to go to class, mm-hmm. you know, but it requires some homework to do this well.
So I'd like to get back to you again. You're a professional trainer, journalism trainer as well. So what do you mean focused on? What you are concerned on? How do you, you know, inspire the aspiring journalist, struggling journalist?
I think journalists are inspiring me.
What is your main objective?
Right. I mean, I think young journalists in particular inspire me. Because they have so much energy, they have so much talent, they have so much desire. It's just wonderful to be around them. I spend most of my time, not just here, but in general, working with television news, so talking about visual storytelling, right? Mm-hmm. How can we use this great advantage we have?
You have a writing on it as well.
I have a textbook, yes, I have a textbook.
So how is it benefited? How is this effective for an aspiring journalist?
Well, I mean, it's there as available training. Mm-hmm. And I think that particularly this younger generation, they're very accustomed to video, the idea that video is part of their lives. And they just need a little bit of help to turn sort of the video part of their lives into what makes really good journalism video. But I also spend a lot of time training on social media.
Okay.
So we're all there. How can we use it productively, professionally? And that's what I focus on.
So I was going through your biography, and I could see that there was online journalism. I was a little bit unaware about that. What is it about? What is exactly online journalism is?
So it basically means on the web, so digital journalism. It is both reporting, using it to report as a tool, and then using it as a publishing platform. Mm-hmm. So I look at both of those things. How can you, for example, scrape data? You know, can you get information? Say there's a UN report that's full of numbers. You know, how can you easily get those numbers, make sense of them, and then share them? And then online, the web, gives the opportunity to provide more information to the user. So they might just want to read the headline, but they really might want to go deeper. So you can provide the whole report, or you can annotate the report, make notes on it,
okay.
So that they can click through and find only the things about Nepal, because you've done the work for them. So that's part of what I do.
Okay, it's definitely an effective journalism. So what do you see? You are here in Nepal now, and you might have compared your journalism sector to that of ours in Nepal. So what do you see? How have you differentiated? How have you variated these two journalism sector? You are from the Western state, mm-hmm. from America. So how have you differentiated? What do you see the level of journalism now?
It's very hard for me to judge. I don't speak Nepali, so I'm at a huge disadvantage when it comes to trying to judge. I have looked at television, you know, just the pictures and the sound, but I can't understand the words. And I've read as many newspapers as possible. Obviously, there's English language.
Articles, so, yeah.
But it's all very different. There's a lot, first of all. There's so much available.
Do you feel any lackings for the initiation to grow the sector?
So in other words, from what I've been able to comprehend, do I see anything missing? It's just the same kinds of things I see missing at home, to tell you the truth. I think journalists tend to be very into the sort of the elites. You know, what are the elites talking about? What's going on at this upper level? And yes, people care about that. They're interested in politics, for sure. But I'm not sure that anywhere that there's enough coverage that says, and this is what it means to you. Right, so I have a small tea shop, let's just say, right? Mm-hmm. And I love to gossip about the politics and who's up and who's down, and that's fine, but what difference would it make to me if the government were to, you know, be completely changed? That's the piece that I see missing here and at home.
Okay, so you have also worked in a national politics level in a sector. So what do you have to say? How have you observed the Nepalese politics? Like recently, lately, the politics has been in a very downfall way. The political dissent and political instability we have been observing. What do you have to say about this? How have you observed the Nepalese politics?
Oh my goodness, it's so complicated. I mean, I think that it's easy to say, oh, there's the left, and then there's the right, and then there's sort of center. Is there a center? We're not sure. But then when you break it down, 100 parties, it's almost impossible for an outsider to figure that out in, you know, I've only been following it for a few months and I've only been here for 5 days. Mm-hmm. So it's almost impossible for me as an outsider who doesn't speak the language to begin with to be able to figure it out. But yes, there's clearly a lot of instability and you're not alone. There's instability in a lot of places in the world. You are still, you know, you have a democratic system. People will have a chance to have their say. And I think the responsibility devolves on us as journalists to help those people make their decision, right? Not to make the decision for them.
What can be the key roles of a journalist?
Right, so to provide information about what difference it might make if one group of people were in power as opposed to another group of people, right? What difference does it make to Nepal, at home and abroad, for the system to be unstable, right? What are the consequences of that? There are plenty of very smart people who have, you know, deep thoughts about this that will have much more to say than I do. But I would want to talk to them and share what they have to say.
Okay, so now we are to the end of the conversation. So lastly, would you like to express any few words for our viewers about the journalism sector, for the aspiring, any advice, any suggestion for the aspiring, struggling journalist?
And we all struggle, right? That's the thing. I think that one thing I would say to the young aspiring journalist is be prepared to struggle. It is not an easy job. If you go into this business thinking you'll be well paid, you'll have good working hours, you'll be respected by all of your peers, forget it. You should maybe look to do something else. It is always, always hard work, but it is very much worth it. It is so exciting. There's always something new every day. I remember years ago when I was just starting out, being on a vacation and sitting around talking with some people I had just met. And one of them was a lawyer, and he had worked on the same case for 8 years. 8 years, the same case. Okay. I thought, I would go crazy. You know, I need something new tomorrow.
Exactly.
So if you're that sort of person, you want something new tomorrow, journalism is great.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your time. It's a privilege having you here.
It was my pleasure, Rashna. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much. Wanunthyo, America ki mahila patrakar Deborah Potter. Havasta aajka lagi karyakram 6 prashna yati nai. News 24 Television, herdai garnu hola. Namaste.